We welcome you back to another session of contemplation from isolation and our reading of Hayatus Sahabah. I hope everyone had a great day, alhamdulillah, and we were able to be productive up until now. If not, then inshallah, hopefully we can listen to the following session, inshallah, about the life of different Sahabi, and hopefully we can implement that into our life, be inspired, be looking forward to something, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وأخرج الطبراني عن ربعي بن حراش قال استأذن عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنه على معاوية رضي الله عنه وقد علقت عنده بطون قريش وسعيد بن العاص جالس عن يمينه فلما راه معاوية مقبلا قال يا سعيد والله لألقين على ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما مسائل يعيا بجوابها فقال له سعيد ليس مثل ابن عباس يعيا بمسائلك فلما جلس قال له معاوية ما تقول في أبي بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه قال رحم الله أبا بكر كان والله للقرآن تاليا وعن الميل نائيا وعن الفحشاء ساهيا وعن المنكر ناهيا وبدينه عارفا ومن الله خائفا وبالليل قائما وبالنهار صائما ومن دنياه سالما وعلى عدل البرية عازما وبالمعروف آمرا وإليه صائرا وفي الأحوال شاكرا ولله في الغدو والرواح ذاكرا ولنفسه بالمصالح قاهرا فاق أصحابه ورعا وكفافا وزهدا وعفافا وبرا وحياطة وزهادة وكفاءة فآقب الله من ثلبه اللعائن إلى يوم القيامة. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa amma ba'd. Yesterday we heard the description of Ali radiallahu anhu and what was his state. Today we are talking about one of the greatest sahabi of all. Actually, it is a consensus among the scholars. All the scholars agree that after the Anbiya alayhimus salatu wassalam, the best person that lived and was to walk on this face of this earth was none other than Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So today we read his description and what were his qualities. And honestly, I really hope that we can take something from these, stories of Sahaba, these descriptions of different Sahaba, how they were in their approach in this world, to this life. So, this is narrated by Tabrani rahimahullah from Rabi' ibn Hirash. He says that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu sought permission from Muawiyah radiallahu anhu to come and sit with him. Abdullah ibn Abbas wanted to come and sit with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And at that time when he was sitting, there were some tribes of Quraysh, some heads of Quraysh were sitting with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. So he sought permission and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu granted him permission, and Sa'id ibn al-As was sitting right beside from his right side, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu's right side, there was Sa'id ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. And when Muawiyah radiallahu anhu saw that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu was coming in and he was sitting down, he said to Sa'id, "Oh Sa'id, listen, I'm about to ask Abdullah ibn Abbas such a question that he's not going to have an answer for it. He won't be able to, not that he won't have an answer, but he won't be able to answer me properly. You know, it's going to be a hard, difficult question for him." So, right away, Sa'id ibn al-As, he knew that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu was no joke. He was a serious companion of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He was a great Sahabi himself. So he said, no, don't worry. There's nothing. Abdullah ibn Abbas is not that type of person that you're going to ask him a question and he won't have the answer for it. Definitely he will have the answer. So he says, when Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu came and he sat by Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, then Muawiyah radiallahu anhu told him, Abdullah, what do you say? What do you say about Abu Bakr? Can you tell me about Abu Bakr? Remember we spoke about Muawiyah radiallahu anhu asking Dirar ibn Damrata al-Kinani radiallahu anhu, rahimahullah, that, you know, Sifli Ali, can you tell me, can you describe me Ali radiallahu anhu? And he excused himself. He said, can I be excused? He said, no, you can't, tell me. So he went on and he told him about the description of Ali radiallahu anhu. So today he's asking, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he's asking this Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. And Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he's not looking for any excuse. He said right away, no problem. He says, رحم الله أبا بكر. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And just listen to the description of this Sahabi describing Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Remember, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was that individual who gave everything that he had, that he possessed for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He had given everything. He was the best friend of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the one who accompanied Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he was doing Hijrah. He was migrating from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Madinah al-Munawwarah. No one else went with him. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu went with him. Took the risk of his life. Right? So, and in the cave when they were hiding, they were taking rest, and the kuffar, they came on top of the cave and they're right at the opening of this place. And, you know, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, if they were to just look down towards their feet, they would have, la'absarana, they would see us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, he comforted him. He said, ma dhannuka bithnaini ya Abu Bakr? What do you think about those two people of Abu Bakr? That Allahu thalithuhuma, that the third one with the two is Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. And eventually they migrated and the story goes on. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when his story will come, and you know how, when he took shahada, what happened? He couldn't control himself. He was so excited and he had to, you know, carry out this work that, you know, he understood, right, when he took shahada and he wanted to invite others towards this goodness. He couldn't content himself. And he went outside and he did what he did and he received what he received, the type of treatment, inshallah. I don't want to talk about that today because that's to come, inshallah. However, this is just to give us an idea that who was Abu Bakr? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was such a person that after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the one who held on to the responsibilities of the Muslims. He took over from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was in charge of the Muslims. And he did so diligently, mashallah, tabarakallah, and we'll see in his stories. Anyhow, so we're talking about him, and now this Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, is taking the time to describe this Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He says, رحم الله أبا بكر. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on Abu Bakr. والله للقرآن تاليا وعن المين نائيا. That verily, I swear by Allah, that this man used to recite the Quran so much. He used to recite the Quran a lot, all the time. You find him very often recite Quran, and he is one of those people that would be far away from misguidance. He would not deviate from his path. He would be always on track. He was always, his eyes were always, you know, on what was needed to be done. He was always on the right track. He would always follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did not get distracted. وَعَنِ الْفَحْشَاهِ سَاهِيَا وَعَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ نَاهِيَا. When it came to immodesty and immorality, he was the one who would go the other direction. If there was something wrong that was being done, some kind of sin that was being committed, he was nowhere near to be found. This was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And he would tell people as well, not that only that he would stay away from bad, rather he would also tell others that, my dear respected brothers, my sisters, my fellow human being, my fellow Muslims, stay away from these things. He wouldn't just worry about himself, rather he would tell others as well. وَبِدِينِهِ عَارِفًا وَمِنَ اللَّهِ خَائِفًا. He was someone who knew his deen. It wasn't just he was shooting arrows in the dark. No, 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 no. He knew his deen. He understood what was his responsibility. He understood what was given to him from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He knew. So he was someone who knew about his deen. He was knowledgeable. وَمِنَ اللَّهِ خَيْفَ. But that knowledge of his did not stop him from being fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, sometimes we have knowledge, we acquire a little bit of, you know, knowledge from here and there. And today in the day and age of, you know, YouTube and Facebook and Twitter and, you know, whatnot, Google and Yahoo and subhanAllah, it's very easy to get knowledge, mashallah. I wouldn't call that knowledge, that is information. Knowledge is something different. But definitely people can get a lot of information. And once a person gets information, all of a sudden they feel, I know. And the people who might be on a different path, or they might be on a different of a different opinion, now all of a sudden we feel, just because we know, we feel greater, we feel better, we feel like, you know, this Sahabi, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, having the status that he had, yet he was so knowledgeable, yet he was fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبِاللَّيْلِ قَائِمًا وَبِالنَّهَارِ صَائِمًا. He was often standing at night in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His nights were spent in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in salah, in qiyam, in long qiyam, in long rakat of salah. And during the day, he wouldn't take rest and just be like, okay, it's fine. During the day, he was fasting as well. At night, he was praying tahajjud. During the day, he was fasting. وَمِن دُنْيَاهُ سَالِمًا. He was staying in such a way in this dunya. And we see this quality in all the sahabi so far that we have discussed. Not that you live in this world and you are so detached that, you know, people feel that you're an outcast. No, no, no. You need to take from this dunya and, you know, as much as you need. Like we keep on repeating to ourselves, that we are in this world as travelers. So live like a traveler. Take which is needed. Leave which is extra. So he was somebody who did not get affected by the dunya. He would stay very, very clear. He would stand clear of all the attractions of this dunya. Actually, in fact, any dunya that he had, he possessed, he gave it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the uplifting of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَلَىٰ عَدْلِ الْبَرِيَّةِ عَزِمًا. He was very, very, very careful and conscious, and he was very committed to do justice for the people. Because he was a ruler. He was somebody who was entrusted with the responsibility of the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam after his demise. So he was responsible for that, and he took care of that. He was very, very committed to his responsibilities. وَبِالْمَعْرُوفِ آمِرًا وَإِلَيْهِ سَائِرًا. And he would often tell people, he would invite them towards good, and he himself would follow. This is another thing. It's very easy for me to sit here and, you know, give you long lectures and read all these things. And mashallah, and you say, oh mashallah, it's so nice, sahaba were good, and this man, he's, you know, he's telling us. Yeah, it's for easy for me to say what I'm saying, but am I practicing it as well? This was his practice and the practice of all the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they would not only invite others towards good and righteousness, but rather they would practice it themselves. They wouldn't just, you know, let it be. وَفِي الْأَحْوَالِ شَاكِرًا وَلِلَّهِ فِي الْغُضُوِّ وَالرَّوَاحِ ذَاكِرًا. And in any condition, this is a lesson that we should take as Muslim during these hard times, during these times of lockdown, during this time of isolation, during this time of quarantine, we should really, really be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today I had to go out because, you know, yesterday I went to meet my parents and my car broke down on the way back. So I took it to the garage. Today I took my car out and the gas station was right there. So I had to take some gas. And subhanAllah, I filled it up at, I think, 66 cents. 66 cents for gas. So I said, and I shared it with a few friends, that subhanAllah, look at this, 66 cents for gas. Not everything, maybe we might think this is bad, but it comes with so many blessings. It's blessings in disguise. You know, we live in Canada, alhamdulillah. We have so many bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so many blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, this is definitely hard for us, but we have to look for all the positive things during these hard times. That's what a believer does. And he's thankful of everything that he has. If these hard times do not make us realize everyone's talking about when are we going to return to normal again? When are we going to go back to the normal, life that we had once upon a time? Well, we should be first thankful. That life, yesterday I went to Walmart. I had to get something, get some shopping done. And I had to stand in front of Walmart in the rain. I had to stand in the rain. And subhanAllah, there was a lineup because of social distancing. Until now, we used to walk into any store, any grocery store, supermarket. And we didn't have to wait. We walk at will. We come out at will. And no waiting, no nothing. SubhanAllah, if anything, we wait at the cash register a little bit. SubhanAllah, yesterday, it made me realize how great of blessings these little things are that we overlook. Every few minutes, somebody was coming into the aisle and telling us that, you should hurry up, people are waiting, hurry up, subhanAllah. So, all this, we need to understand that everything is blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in disguise. And if we can't point out what is good, then when are we going to do this? We have to benefit from these times. We have to look at the positive in these times. So, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he used to look at the positive and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala no matter what, in any situation. وَفِي الْأَحْوَالِ شَاكِرًا. No matter what situation he was in, he would be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِلَّهِ فِي الْغُدُوِّ وَالرَّوَاحِ ذَاكِرًا. And doing all these things wouldn't stop him from being thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and show his gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be indulged in the dhikr and the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine a man, given the task of taking care of the whole ummah, he was the Khalifatul Muslimin, yet he would not forget his own dhikr of Allah. He would still find time at night to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, during the day to fast, and in the morning and night he would take time to read Quran. He would take time to the dhikr and do the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِنَفْسِهِ بِالْمَصَالِحِ قَاهِرًا. And he was very strict. He was very strict when it came to himself. He would often, assess his life. And he would see how can he better himself. I keep repeating this to me and to anybody that I'm talking to as of late. That we have to make, positive changes in our lives during these days. These days are very, very important for us. Because when else are we going to get this kind of chance to really think, stop and think, where the whole world is coming to a halt and a stop? When else are we going to get a chance to think like this and make an effort to, be better? So this was something that used to be practiced by the Sahaba, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu used to do this. He used to be very strict when it came to his own reformation. Then he goes on to say, فَاقَ أَصْحَابُهُ وَرْعًا وَكَفَافًا. That he exceeded and he excelled, he surpassed any of his companions. Umar radiallahu anhu, he used to always try to kind of do a little bit more than Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He used to always try to overtake him, and in goodness, in righteousness, in good deeds. Yet he never found an occasion where he can over. One time he thought he could, he brought so much. He brought half of his wealth and he gave it to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, this is for the believers, this is for the Muslims, and this is for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he had a lot and he had given it. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he was asked, what did you bring, Abu Bakr? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied, the question to Abu Bakr was, what did you leave, Abu Bakr? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied, I left the Messenger of Allah and Allah in my house. I have brought everything else but that. Because he brought very little. He didn't have anything. But whatever he had, he left nothing behind. At that occasion, on that instant, Umar radiallahu anhu said, there is no way I can overtake this man or outdo this man. This man is really, really, this is that very man that once, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, he comes and he says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that, Ya Rasulullah, Inna salam yaqri'u ala Aba Bakrin salam. That ya Rasulullah, please tell your companion Abu Bakr that As-Salam, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he himself is sending salam to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. That didn't happen just like that. This is because of these qualities that he possessed, these amazing, magnificent qualities that he possessed. Because of that, as a result, in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent salam upon him. Now, carrying on. So he said he overtook his friends you know, his companions in piety and in him staying away from this world, his abstinence from this world, in chasteness, his virtue, and he used to be one who used to keep his promises. He used to be the one who was very disciplined. He was very cautious in returning people their amana. If he had borrowed something, if he had taken something, if he had taken something from someone, he was very cautious about these things. And, you know, he had surpassed all of his companions in these regards. Then he goes on to say, فَأَقَبَ اللَّهُ مَنْ ثَلَبَهُ اللَّعَائِنَ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ, that anybody who will say anything bad about this man, know that this man was someone great. And anybody who says otherwise, they will definitely be held accountable in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that, in the day of judgment. So my respected brothers and sisters, what do we see from these companions, their lives? Inshallah, tomorrow will be, you know, Umar radiallahu anhu, then Uthman radiallahu anhu, then Ali radiallahu anhu, and then we'll continue, inshallah. The same hadith continues. Today we just read about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and this was how great of a man he was. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, enable me and you, honestly, to really, you know, focus and kind of, you know, make a change in our life and, you know, learn from these people. If me and you can't find time to read Quran, we don't have the responsibility of the whole Muslim Ummah on our shoulders, and we are not able to find time to read Quran. We're rushing in our salah. Even in our salah now, we're rushing, subhanAllah. What do we have to get back to? To what? If we can't concentrate on our salah now, then when are we going to concentrate on our salah? Everything takes effort. Practice makes perfect. The other day I had a talk in another place, and over there they're asking me about khushu of salah. I said, subhanAllah, we need to practice. It's not going to come overnight. We have to practice. So if this time we're not going to use it to our, you know, our advantage and try to make our salah proper, you know, spend some time in salah, talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, spend some time learning Quran and reading Quran, reciting Quran, spend some time reading the translation of the Quran, meaning of the Quran, spend some time helping around in the house, you know, do these things. If we can't do it now, then when are we going to do it? I hope, inshallah, you know, out of all these qualities that we read today of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, if we can take the quality of his salah, maybe make intention to stand up, you know, first of all, make our 5 times salah daily, and with a little bit more concentration and devotion, and also try to wake up at night, you know, and pray for tahajjud salah if we can do this. If we can, then go to sleep praying 2 extra rakat of salah, saying, Ya Allah, I don't know if I'm going to wake up, but this is my intention for tahajjud salah, and I'm offering these 2 rakat. And inshallah, from tomorrow, if we can make intention, those of us who are listening and hafiz, at least 3 juz, if not 5 juz a day. And those of us who are not hafiz, at least a few pages of the Quran every day should be recited by us. Inshallah, I hope we can do this. And again, we make dua for all those people. My friend Samir, I mentioned his aunt is currently, her situation worsened this morning, and she's on, they say, level 6. And 1 to 10, 10 is the worst. She's at level 6 and she's still on ventilator. Please make dua for her and make dua for all those Muslims all around the world who are suffering from this disease. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring ease. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring shifa. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a relief from all of this, inshallah. And we pray those of us who are making good intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our intentions. And I hope that, inshallah, we can all tune in tomorrow again for another session of contemplation from isolation. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين